welcome to our series of lectures on the general theme of signification in Buddhist and Freud traditions. Why we compare these two traditions? It follows a statement by Sherbatsky, the Russian thinker, who in his Buddhist logic stated that the Indian medieval logic is filled up with a struggle between realism and nominalism, just as the Middle Ages in Europe. There is an unmistakable parallelism between the European struggle and the Indian controversy. Its general lines are similar, but not its details. It can be mentioned that Abelard, in his attempt at mediation between extreme nominalism and extreme realism, expressed views which are partially found in India. Now, this is the basic statement which in a way authorizes us to compare the debates in India between the Indian realists and the Buddhists, not nominalist but conceptualist, because Buddhist thinking is called by several scholars as conceptual, just as the Abelardian position is also considered by a number of scholars as conceptual, which really means that it is it negotiates between the extreme realism and extreme nominalism, as stated by Sherbatsky. For an introduction, we can state the realist position and how the Buddhists differ with it. For the realists, which is the Vedic tradition in India, verbal testimony is the cornerstone of all thinkers of the realist tradition of all the four classical Indian schools. For all of them, language is a natural phenomenon and the correspondence between form and content is fixed. The most sacred task for the priests is to recite the Vedic texts in specific rituals in their absolute purity, in sound and significance. Both Panini and Bhartriyari follow this program and provide the guardians of religion with the most precise description of phonetics, morphology and syntax ever written of any language. Bhartriyari presents a theory of semantics with his formulations of Sphot. If there are any theoretical differences, they are found in the approaches of these two grammarians. For Dignaga and Dharmakirti, language is always considered as conventional, and while the morphological and syntactic constructs of language are not ignored, they are never the basis of any approach to knowledge. Apoho, as the theory of signification, is not at all about the meanings of words or sentences as grammatical constructs, but as enunciations constituted in the field of enunciation. Apoha is not about grammatical semantics with which Bhartriyari is preoccupied. It is the theory of signification in the domain of conceptual correlations and dichotomizing dialectic. It is the theory of semiotics of enunciation, of discursive formations in the constitution of discourse. Now, we follow the basic steps in the theoretical framework of Dharmakirti. For him, the object is a reality that is eternally in flux. So, the first contact with the reality is the beginning of any process of acquiring knowledge, but this reality is eternally in flux. So, the contact is only what is called in Buddhist vocabulary with point instants, and as soon as this contact takes place, it is already past. Again, this object is a reality that is eternally in flux. With our senses, we can but have a momentary contact with it. In fact, it is followed by its memory, its image that is preserved in our ken. See, after the first contact, what is left, you see, since the reality as such is no more there, it is already past. So, what the the person who has had this contact, he retains in his can in his mind the memory and the image of that object. The object of knowledge is not even the object of contact, but its image, which is abstract, which is similar to the object perceived, but it is never identical with it. So, this is very important. The image of the object on which the researcher, the thinker works, or which is analyzed, it is never identical with it, but it is similar. In Buddhist terminology, it is called this coordination between the image and the object of contact is called sarupya. You see, there is a coordination, but it is, there is no absolute identity. That is, this concrete reality, which is also eternal for the realists, leads to the concrete reality, the formal expression of language, its phonetics and syntax, as a natural phenomenon. For the realists, the reality is concrete, and the expression of that reality, that is language, is also concrete. This is why their absolute emphasis on its pronunciation, its phonetics and morphology. So, this is why both Panini and Bhartriyari concentrate on the formal aspect of language. You see, for the Buddhists, it is different. No such thing for the Buddhist logicians. For Dharmakirti, as before him for Dignag, language as a formal expression worthy of recitational purity does not exist. The name that will ultimately correspond to the conceptual image is only a conceptual enunciation, and as such subject only to dichotomizing dialectic. So, again the word, the concept of conceptual is repeated again and again. So, this is a very important term in Buddhist terminology. The grammatical constructs are respected, but their formal dictates do not decide the significance attached to them by the grammarians. So, you see, not that the formal aspect of language is ignored, it is not ignored. Still, it is very important to pronounce the words in its in their phonetic purity, and the grammatical constructs must also be respected. But as far as the signification is concerned, they do not play the same role as they play for the Buddhists. The proper function of knowledge, as for the Buddhists, is the right cognition of the object, where it is cognized as directly perceived. Inference, on the other hand, is indirect. So, you have two situations, perception and inference. At the level of perception, there is a physical contact, it is a sensuous contact, but once this contact has taken place, it is followed by the image of that object, and on that the scholar works, and it works through the operation of inference. Inference, on the other hand, is indirect. You see, the perception is direct, inference is indirect due to the logical apprehension of its mark. With sense perception, we apprehend a definite object. This is very important. With sense perception, we apprehend a definite object. With inference, its conceptual construct. So, this is the main Buddhist position, which is already quite different from the realist position. The sensuous contact is supposed to be passive, but in Buddhist framework, this passivity is immediately followed by the active operation of the intellect, where the passive perception functions as a stimulant. See, the first step, the first sensuous contact functions as a stimulant for further inference and dialectical analysis. Hence, even the sensuous contact is not so passive, because it functions as a stimulant. After all, since there is a logical continuity from one step to another, metonymically, in this case, its basic nature is dynamic. The constitution or the apprehension of signification, the constitution of signification, and then thirdly, the articulation of signification is a dynamic process. It is a logical process, it is an intellectual process. It is followed by inference that is not only dialectical, but also paradigmatic and metaphoric, transcending all space and time. See, this is very important. There are two basic hypotheses, metonymic operation and paradigmatic relation. In the metonymic relation is linear regression. You have a first contact and then first step follows another, second, third, fourth and so forth. But the conceptual process is not only linear, but it is non-linear. That is, it is not only metonymic, it is also paradigmatic or metaphoric. You go back and forth to establish new correlations, and these new correlations help us understand arrive at the proper signification. There are two varieties of knowledge, direct and indirect, or perceptive and inferential. These two sources are identical. As through senses or perception, we come in contact with a given object, which is always in flux, its memory leaves an image which functions as a stimulant. Now, this is very important, these two words, first the first contact and then memory of that contact, and which leaves an image, its memory leaves an image which functions as a stimulant, that this memory functions as a stimulant for further inference, for further logical construction. But this is very important, there is a coordination, or the word sarupya is used. There is a coordination or sarupya between perception and inference. In other words, even though perception does not lead to any specific identification, its coordination with the following dialectical conceptual construction is imperative. The second statement is very important. Conceptualism does not take place in a void, that however abstract that conceptualism may be, however abstract logical dialectic may be, there is always a specific reference to the object, to the real object. So, the what is signified is never ignored, you see, though there is a movement from the contact to memory to image to inference, but there is always the importance of sensuous contact is not minimized. We move from the concrete to the abstract and from the abstract to the concrete, but this process of abstraction is extremely important for any intellectual incision. This process of abstraction is also very important, but we must never forget the first contact with the object. Perception and inference are not only direct and indirect, they are also passive and active. Their coordinated method produces the right knowledge. The realists admit a greater number of pramanas, but insist that the perception is the most important. For the realists, not only the unique particular, but also the universal characteristic which is supposed to be residing in it is also apprehended by sensation. This is the real difference between the realist and the conceptualist. For the realist, even the universal, even the characteristic of a thing, you see, for example, say apple, the word apple there is the concrete object, but its being sweet or its being round or its being red, these are also as concrete as the other. They are these characteristics for the realist. Dignaga and Dharmakirti school, that is the Buddhist school, does not admit of any other method. For them, not only perception and inference are the two sources, two processes, they are also exhaustive. In other words, sense and intellect work together. In coordination, they cover all fields of knowledge. Furthermore, it is also important to note that it is only in the coordinated dialectical exercise of these two that the right knowledge is acquired. Perception and inference never operate separately. Now, this is very important, that even though they are distinct from each other, but they act together. There is a coordination between the operation of senses and which is followed by intellect or inference. According to Dharmakirti, analytical deductions are the deductions of coexistence. Since this term coexistence is very important, and we'll follow how it works. All these attributes, which are given as reasons for the deduction of corresponding predicates, the characteristics, should be conceived as logical reasons for deducing only such predicates whose necessary dependence on nothing but the presence of reason is established by proofs. This is a little complicated statement, but it is simplified further. The predicated attribute is deduced because it is inferred from a relation of dependence. There is a relation of dependence, they are interdependent with each other. Dharmotra, another great Buddhist scholar, states that logical reason is not like a lamp whose light accidentally reveals the presence of things. On the other hand, it depends upon inferred conclusions, upon logical correlates, which alone are responsible for deductions. The relations are existential, even coexistential. This is very important, that the two terms which relate with each other, or to any entities which whose relations we are talking about, their existence is very important. Not only this relation is existential, it is even coexistential, for it is always the interdependence of one fact upon another that proves a given existence. Even to prove that something exists, whether it is through sensuous operation or through in the domain of imaginaire through conceptualism, there is always the interdependence of one fact upon the other. It is this interdependence, the coexistence, or that proves that existence. Now we have another important point here in the theory of apohavad. Generally, this theory is considered the theory of negation. Now, this is contradicted by the Buddhist logicians. I mean, their position is, it is interesting to note that while the realists insist on perceiving absence or non-existence by senses, they impute the theory of negation to the Buddhists, for whom the presence or absence is a matter of inference or analytical reason. See, for the Buddhists, whether something is present or absence, that is deduced by inference. That is not a matter of fact. Dharmakirti says very clearly that negation deals only with sensibilia, and sensibilia is the domain of the realist philosophers. That negation operates within the domain of sensibilia. You see, for the Buddhist logicians, negative or positive sensibilia remain sensibilia. Whether the sensibilia, the domain of sensibilia, is negative or positive, it still operates within the domain of sensibilia, which are never taken as logical entities. These are not logical entities as far as the Buddhists are concerned. The logical correlates are always abstract, and their relations are only existentially established. The senses play no role in these correlations. This is very important to note, that they play no role in the process of inference. Furthermore, this is another important theoretical issue in Buddhist apohavad. There are four kinds of contradiction. That there is a long discussion on contradiction in which we cannot go here, but a short summary. There are four kinds of contradictions. The first contradiction refers to perception. When something can be perceived, but is not perceived, as in the case of the sound not being perceived by hearing. The second refers to the deduction by inference, as in the case of the sounds of speech by eternal entities. It is contradictory, for the sounds of speech have an origin and are products. They are impermanent, like all those things which are produced and have an origin as a jar. This is very important issue, because for the realist in the Vedic tradition, for the Mimamsa and Sankhya and others, there the sounds are eternal. This is why language is eternal. This is why the language becomes sacred, and its pronunciation and its grammar becomes they are very, very important in the Vedic tradition, for the especially for the sacred rituals. As far as the Buddhists are concerned, this is not the case. A proposition such as the word hair mark is a mental construct, and its identity with the moon is conceptual. They are mental constructs and they are conceptual. They do not have sensuous reality. What corresponds to a constructed image is capable of coalescing with a word, and what is capable of coalescing with a word can be designated by a name chosen arbitrarily by convention. You see, this theoretical framework of apoha presented by Dharmakirti and commented upon by Dharmotra establishes the logical validity of both the construction of mental images and the conventional nature of language that corresponds with them. These are the two important theoretical issues for Buddhism, the logical validity of the construction of mental images and the conventional nature of language that corresponds with it. Conceptual construction leads to the distinct cognition of a mental reflex. The linguistic denomination of this cognition is based on the coordination between the reflex and its proper identification. The word, or the linguistic denomination, that means the word, the signifier, is based on the coordination between the reflex and its proper identification. So there is the idea of the thing, the concept of the object, but the object still remains. Its concept of the object is still of the object and not constituted in a void. Furthermore, it is also a matter of self-consciousness. We become conscious of the presence of an object. It is followed by the mental phenomenon that apprehends the special states of consciousness. Every flash of consciousness and every mental state is self-conscious. When we apprehend an object in its external form, we become self-conscious of its presence. This is the first sensuous contact. This mental state leads to internal experience or an internal image of the object experienced. This image is constructed in the domain of constructive imagination, lingeja vikalpa. See, this is very important. The image that is constituted, that constructed, it is in the domain of constructive imagination. So this image is not sensuous at all. Mental image does not correspond to any, this mental image does not correspond to any empirical reality. For the image of a universal feature can be produced without the real existence of a universal. In fact, the universal is not a thing in any sense of the term. The universal is a characteristic. See, for example, man, a given man is a physical entity, but the rationality of man, the immortality of man, these features, these universal features are not things in that sense of the term. They are only concepts. Finally, there is a since we begin with comparison of realism and nominalism, both these concepts between the European tradition and the Indian tradition, we see that this comparison does not work in detail. It may also be pointed out that even when there are similarities, the comparison with the European realist nominalist misleading, because the Indian realists do not act exactly like the European realists or the Indian nominalists or the Buddhists do not follow or do not correspond exactly with the theories of the European nominalists. Because of their absolute dependence upon sensation, the eternal soul of the Mimamsa and the eternal substance of the Sankhya acquire a quasi anthropological and quasi cosmological status. For Mimamsa, the emphasis is on the eternal soul, and for Sankhya, the emphasis is on eternal substance. So there is sort of eternity in both cases, whether it is soul or substance. So they acquire what is called quasi anthropological and quasi cosmological status. We do not see this admixture in Plato and his realism. In the case of Plato, it is not so. His ideas are absolutely pure. They do not depend on any given object. See, there is the kind of follow up on the theory of theory of language, which Panini and Barthiri follow and explicate. This does not happen in the European tradition, in the Platonic tradition, in Platonic realism. Actually, that happens in the Aristotelian tradition. So, it is halfway. We do not see this admixture in Plato and his realism. The universe of the ideas of Plato does not admit of any materiality whatsoever. The Buddhist notion of kalpana comes closest to this position, except that in the Buddhist theoretical framework, as deliberated in the theory of apoho, the theory of signification par excellence, there is a definite coordination, sarupya, with the external materiality, even if it is momentary and refers to the reality in flux. So, even if the reality is in flux and even if this contact is only momentary, this the coordination with the object is very important in the Buddhist tradition. As a result, it does not follow the realist position or the Aristotelian position. The way Panini and Barthiri describe and analyze language, they come closest to the Aristotelian position as compared with the Buddhist logicians, whose intellectual incision in apohavad present them with opposite hypotheses. What happens in the Indian tradition is they begin from absolute realism and they end up, especially in their analysis of language, towards more nominalism as presented by the ideas of Aristotle. Language being a natural phenomenon for the celebrated grammarians and conventional institution for the Buddhists, they end up moving in the epistemological directions they probably never considered seriously. Thank you. This is the end of the second lecture. The third lecture on the same theory of apohavad and Abelardian conceptualism will concentrate on Abelardian conceptualism. So the third lecture will be on Abelardian conceptualism, which is in a way will refer to the second lecture and even the first lecture. So these lectures are in a series. They succeed in presentation also, and succeed one followed by the other, both in explanation and in theoretical understanding. So whoever wants to follow these lectures, it's better to follow from the first to the seventh, because there is a continuity of logical explanation and continuity of theoretical interpretations also. Thank you.